Musical Hell is hitting the high seas next year. Check out the video information to find out how you can join me and the hit musical Six on the Norwegian Bliss. This episode of Musical Hell is brought to you by Midnight Musicals. Welcome to the podcast Musical Underground. And by Cafe Himbo Cookbooks, celebrating his 10th anniversary. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Diva from Musical Hell, and I know the score.
Several years ago, I reviewed the film adaptation of The Wiz, and while I talked a lot about where I felt the movie fell short, I didn't delve too much into the source material or its overall significance in music theater history, which is kind of a big deal, especially when you consider the form's shaky history with race in general. So for Black History Month, let's discuss the Super Soul musical, how it became a surprise hit, and why it's an important turning point for Black representation on stage.
Come on in. He's on down, he's on down the road. Come on in, he's on down.
Let's start with a quick history overview, because musicals are an American art form, and as such they have some uniquely American baggage in the form of their predecessor, the minstrel show. Although they're now infamous for their liberal use of blackface and perpetuating harmful stereotypes like the mammy and the happy darky, minstrel shows were immensely popular throughout the 19th century, and one of the most widespread forms of mass entertainment before, during, and even for a while after the Civil War. Such was the prevalence of the minstrel show that one of the few ways for Black performers to make a career was to put on blackface, becoming an exaggerated caricature of themselves for the amusement of the audience. The first all-Black musicals on Broadway, like In Dahomey and Shuffle Along, labored under the popular expectations of minstrelsy with stock characters and routines like the cakewalk. And while these shows worked to expand on and even subvert those tropes, the fact that they're still there are a huge part of why those shows passed into obscurity. The minstrel show itself fell out of favor with the rise of vaudeville and musical theater, but the shadow it cast was very long, with amateur companies persisting well into the 20th century. And as far as Broadway was concerned, there wasn't a whole lot taking its place. Black representation on the Great White Way in the 30s and Golden Age was limited, and mostly in shows by white writers like the Gershwins' Porgy and Bess, and the all-Black cast of Hello, Dolly! Headed by Pearl Bailey. It's not until after the Civil Rights era that musicals created by and starring Black artists started coming to the forefront again. And that brings us to The Wiz. The Wiz was one of several all-Black musicals mounted in the early 1970s, but several things set it apart. The first and foremost is the score. Like Godspell and Hair, Charlie Small's work for The Wiz was inspired by the music filling the radio airwaves at the time, specifically Motown. Drawing on the sound that was sending the likes of Diana Ross and the Jackson 5 to superstar status, Small's vibrant score ranges from Eveline's gospel-style villain song, Don't Nobody Bring Me No Bad News, to the deeply soulful slow jam, What Would I Do If I Could Feel?
I could cry, I could smile, I could lay back for a while. What would I do if I came?
The second is the way it reimagines The Wizard of Oz through a Black lens. The theme of liberation runs very strongly through The Wiz, culminating in the brilliant 11 o'clock anthem, Brand New Day.
Hello, world! It's like a different way of living now. Thank you, world! We always knew that we'd be free somehow.
Equally important is the theme of self-validation. A story in which characters who think they are lacking somehow but learn through the course of their journey that they are and can do more than the world has led them to believe hits differently when it's told through a Black perspective. Especially when the social conditioning that fostered those negative mindsets is demonstrated in You Can't Win, a song written for the film version and included in the 2015 live telecast.
You can't break even, and you can't get out of the game.
Today, The Wiz is easily the most widely known black musical, but it almost wasn't. The initial critical reaction was mixed, and for the first few weeks, the show was in real danger of closing as a flop. But 20th Century Fox poured money in to keep things going, while an aggressive marketing campaign was launched, including one of the first television commercials for a Broadway show. The television and radio ads were directed not to the traditional white theater audience, but to black markets, and it paid off. The original production would run for 4 years, supported by audiences eager to see a black story that didn't center on slavery, poverty, or crime, told in vernacular and music that echoed their own. The same attraction made the film version a holiday staple on BET and TV1. But being a qualified hit can be a double-edged sword. Minstrel shows were ultimately fueled by white audiences eager to experience black culture, or a facsimile thereof, at arm's length, and that impulse still persists today. As Wesley Morris writes for the 1619 Project, "Loving black culture has never demanded a corresponding love for black people, and loving black culture has tended to result in loving the life out of it. Whether it's The Wiz, Once on This Island, or In the Heights, white music theater performers and audiences tend to want to claim non-white stories for their own, even though the landscape is still very much tilted in their favor." Nearly 50 years after Dorothy and Friends eased on down the road, diversity on Broadway is still a slow process, with long runners like Wicked and Phantom of the Opera only recently casting black leading ladies. And even well-intentioned attempts at inclusion can falter, as the line between racial representation and racial caricature can be very fuzzy and dependent on individual perspective. The protagonists of Passing Strange and A Strange Loop struggle with mainstream black culture, in no small part because they don't see a place for themselves in it. Finally, the march of progress, slow though it is, means that what was once daring and subversive for its time can become passé, even uncomfortably dated. But with a solid score, a timeless story, and a lot of heart, The Wiz is in a good position to endure for many years to come. I'm Diva, I know the score, and now, so do you.